Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Alphonso Davies, A New Hope, by Farhan Devji, narrated by Shawn K. Jain. Introduction. I remember the first time I spoke to Alphonso Davies. It was before he became the face of Canadian men's soccer and a beacon of hope for the national team. It was before his inspiring story was plastered across TV, phone, and computer screens worldwide. It was before he made a multi-million dollar move to one of the biggest soccer clubs on the planet. It was before all the fame. Davies, then a member of the Youth Academy for Major League Soccer MLS club Vancouver Whitecaps FC, had just turned 15 a few months prior. No one outside his family, friends, and a very small circle in the Canadian soccer community would have even known his name. And if you ask any single one of them, many of whom you'll hear from throughout this book, they'll tell you the same thing. He's mostly the same person now as he was back then, only with a bigger trophy case, a thicker wallet, and a few more million social media followers. As we sat down in the lobby of a grandiose hotel in Tucson, Arizona, of all places, where the Whitecaps had convened for a training camp in February 2016, it became clear that Davies was still just a kid. He was polite and well-mannered, but his answers were brief. He was reluctant to maintain eye contact, and he mumbled his words at times. Before I arrived, and after I departed, Davies was fixated on his phone, instead of the picturesque desert mountains that surrounded us. But this wasn't just any kid. Rather, the picture of a grounded individual with a deep appreciation for his upbringing and the opportunity in front of him started to emerge. During that interview, Davies shared some of the hardships his parents had to endure so he could have a better life. Where we were living before, there were no opportunities for me and my family to be something, he said matter-of-factly. The details of their past, at least as he knew them at the time, were murky. It's not something they spoke about often. But the underlying message, which Davies summed up perfectly when we broached the topic again a year later, was crystal clear. Stay humble at all times, he said when asked about the values his parents instilled in him. You don't want to get carried away in anything you do. Stay humble. Keep your feet on the ground. You came from nothing and you're coming to something, so you have to keep that mindset going. These very words provide the backdrop for what MLS Commissioner Don Garber once described to me as one of the great soccer stories in the world. It's the honor of my career to tell this story. Chapter 1. Refugee Baby. Phonzie! 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 The chants of his nickname reverberated across the stadium and around the world. They were certainly heard at the Buduburum refugee camp, where amongst the embers of war, a boy named Alphonso Davies was born at the turn of the century, where those who remained saw him as a shining light that emerged from 3 decades of darkness. They were heard from coast to coast in Canada, the country that gave Davies and his family a second chance at life. And they were heard in Europe. This was the UEFA Champions League, after all. Most of the home crowd had already departed, but a die-hard contingent of traveling Bayern Munich supporters stayed back to send off their team, who had just beaten English Premier League giants Chelsea 3-0, and to serenade their reluctant superstar. Davies wasn't quite sure how to react. As ever, he was grinning from ear to ear. On this brisk Tuesday night at Stamford Bridge, an iconic football stadium in West London, his smile was even wider than usual, and that's saying something. Davies had just played the biggest match of his young career, against the team he'd grown up watching on TV with his dad in their Northside Edmonton apartment. He was, quite literally, living his dream. At the same time, Davies was always taught to stay humble and keep his head down. He has his mom to thank for that. So he began to walk off the pitch with his teammates. He didn't get very far. Bayern's megastar striker Robert Lewandowski gently pushed him back towards the singing supporters. This was Phonzie's moment. Just minutes earlier, the 19-year-old had sent shockwaves across the soccer world with a jaw-dropping assist that affirmed his claim as one of the game's brightest young stars. It started as a routine play. Davies received the ball a few yards before the halfway line, where he was hugging the left touchline as he so often does. Instinctively, he positioned his body towards the opposition goal as he caressed the pass from a teammate and took a clean first touch. That's when he saw it. After a quick pass to Philippe Coutinho in midfield, Davies was off to the races. A trio of Chelsea players formed a triangle around him, but Davies accelerated right through the middle and picked up the bouncing loose ball that had been left behind. Now in full flight, he cleverly flicked the ball up past a sliding fourth Chelsea defender, leaving an awkward trail of disoriented bodies in his dust. The crowd rose to its feet as Davies attacked the open space. They had just witnessed something special, and it wasn't over yet. Finally, Davies capped off his blistering run with an inch-perfect pass across the face of goal to Lewandowski, who tapped it home at the back post. All this in a mere 10 seconds. In those 10 seconds, Davies wasn't just a soccer player. He was an artist. And this was his masterpiece. As the ball hit the back of the net, Lewandowski, one of the greatest goal scorers of the generation, immediately turned back and pointed at Davies in awe, as did Thomas Müller. That's World Cup winner Thomas Müller. The entire team swarmed him in front of the away supporters section. The kid they call Phonzie had arrived. Alphonso Boyle Davies was born on November 2, 2000, in Gamoa, Buduburum, as it stated on his birth certificate, in the West African nation of Ghana. But his true origins can be traced a little further along the coast to the diminutive country known for being Africa's first independent republic. That country is Liberia, whose unique history helps explain the events that would greatly impact the lives of Davies, his family, and so many of their compatriots. Some more gravely than others. In the late 1800s and early 1900s, most of Africa was colonized by European powers during the scramble for Africa. Not little Liberia. It's one of the few countries in the world that never fell under European dominance. That's because they already had a big brother, as many saw it. Look no further than their national flag. Alternating red and white horizontal stripes, a blue square in the top left corner bearing a white star. It's a near clone to the stars and stripes of the United States of America, representing the close ties between the two nations. In 1816, a group of elite white men living in the U.S. founded the American Colonization Society, ACS, which eventually led to the creation of the country now known as Liberia. The motives of the ACS were a point of contention from the very beginning. Some claimed its goal was simply to end slavery in the U.S., which was still legal in certain states, and to help formerly enslaved black people resettle in Africa. Others believed there was an implicitly racist nature to the organization, born out of a fear that a rising population of freed black people would serve as a detriment to white America. Regardless, the ACS proceeded with its plan and purchased a stretch of land along Africa's western shoreline, which became home to thousands of African Americans who migrated from the U.S., some by choice, others by coercion. And this was the basis upon which Liberia, meaning Land of the Free, was formed. Sadly, it never truly lived up to its name. After remaining under the control of the ACS during its formative years, Liberia would declare independence in 1847. There were still significant American influences, however, including a constitution and flag resembling those of the U.S. And the first president of Liberia was U.S.-born Joseph Jenkins Roberts, who had emigrated from Virginia. For 133 years, in fact, Liberia was ruled by settlers from the U.S., known as the Americo-Liberians, and they had no regard for the more populous indigenous communities that originally occupied the region. In other words, the oppressed became the oppressors. Finally, in 1980, a Liberian named Samuel Doe led a bloody coup to defeat the existing government, and he became the country's first indigenous leader. But that wasn't the end of the violence. It was just the beginning. Doe is remembered by many as a dictator whose regime was marked by human rights abuses and corruption. In an attempt to overthrow him, a rebel group led by Liberian warlord Charles Taylor invaded the country from neighboring Ivory Coast on Christmas Eve 1989. And so began one of the deadliest civil wars in African history. Davies's father, Debe, and mother, Victoria, are Liberian nationals who hail from Maryland County on the southeastern tip of the country. But they were living in the capital city of Monrovia, named after former American President James Monroe, when the war erupted.
"That's where the president was living," Debe said.
They were coming for the president, and they didn't care who got in the way.
Debe said there were instances when he'd be walking along the street, only to have someone shot and killed right behind him.
Victoria recounted having to cross over bodies to go and find food. The sound of gunshots and the sight of brutality would become all too common. Once Doe was eventually captured, he had his clothes stripped away and his ears and fingers cut off in a torture session that was videotaped and broadcast widely. Later, his mutilated corpse was displayed on the streets, an act that only intensified the fighting. It wasn't uncommon to see young children patrolling the streets, firing AK-47s, and large groups of soldiers huddled in the backs of pickup trucks. If not assault rifles, they carried machetes, grenades, or rocket launchers. A lot of them wore street clothes with bandanas or backward hats. Others were shirtless or even fully naked. Some of the men wore wigs and dresses as an intimidation tactic. Buildings were burning down. Streets were deserted or, worse, destroyed.
"It was really, really dangerous," Debe said.
There would be two brutal bouts of civil wars between 1989 and 2003, claiming the lives of hundreds of thousands of Liberians. And many of those affected were children. A documentary produced by Vice, titled The Cannibal Warlords of Liberia, described the 14-year conflict as a post-apocalyptic Armageddon with child soldiers smoking heroin, cross-dressing cannibals, and systematic rape. It sounds like a horror movie, but for many it was reality.
"I saw everything," Debe said.
"It was hard, man. Every day your life is at risk."
It came to a point where Debe and Victoria figured the only way to survive in Liberia was to literally fight for their lives.
But that's not the life they wanted. Not for themselves, and certainly not for their family.
"We didn't have any interest in shooting guns," Debe said.
"So we decided to just escape from there." Amongst the cluster of small signs that appear just off the Accra Cape Coast Highway in Ghana is one that reads Liberian Refugee Camp. In between the big red letters, there's a flag of Liberia on one side and a flag of Ghana on the other. At the bottom, a black arrow points towards the entrance of the camp. If it wasn't for the sign, the camp might be mistaken for any other Ghanaian village. A massive dirt soccer field can be seen from the main road. It's hard to miss. Not only is this where the real ballers play, it's also one of the largest gathering spots on the camp. Opposite the field, there are parked taxis, buses, and usually a few Toyota Land Cruisers belonging to staffers from the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, UNHCR, a UN agency dedicated to helping refugees, forcibly displaced communities, and stateless people. Beyond the entrance, a labyrinth of unpaved roads leads into the different zones of the camp, which the residents first knew as areas associated with specific letters. There are kids everywhere. Some are wearing uniforms, headed to school. Others are naked, bathing in plain sight outside their homes. Some are running around kicking soccer balls, seemingly without a worry in the world. Others are pushing wheelbarrows or carrying gallons of water on their heads, feeling the weight of the world on their shoulders. Music is blaring. Women are going around selling fruits, vegetables, and other food. There are markets. There are restaurants / bars, or chop bars, as the residents call them. There are barber shops, banks, internet cafes, and churches. Lots of churches. There's celebration. There's laughter. There's life. The people here are mostly Liberians. But this isn't war-torn Liberia. This is Buduburum. In 1990, the UNHCR helped the Ghanaian government establish the Buduburum refugee camp to house Liberians who had fled the war. It was the largest refugee camp in Ghana, at one point housing more than 40,000 Liberians. And it was the unlikely birthplace for a future Canadian soccer star. A 141-acre stretch of abandoned church land just west of Accra, Ghana's capital city, Buduburum looked a lot like other refugee camps when the first group of Liberians arrived. There were hundreds, if not thousands, of tents provided by the UNHCR, and not much else. Over time, though, it developed into a lively, self-sufficient community. Many on the outside refer to it as a model refugee camp. The UNHCR and other aid organizations provided various forms of support, education, and training. But most of the businesses were built and run by the refugees. They found a way to make a life for themselves. That's not to say life was easy. There was nothing easy about it. It was very, very hard, Victoria said. Buduburum resembled other impoverished villages in Ghana due to its dusty dirt roads and colorful makeshift shacks the refugees built from brick, clay, and whatever other materials they could scrounge together. Like many others, Dibe said, the family lived in a tent when they first arrived on the camp, before building a one-bedroom shack of their own. Most of the homes would have been no bigger than 20 by 20 feet. They might have one or two rooms, and if you were lucky, a thin mattress to sleep on. Otherwise, it'd be a mat. In some homes, the women would lay down their lapas, traditional cloths a lot of Liberians wrapped around their bodies as garments, for the kids to sleep on. None of the homes had proper bathrooms. Instead, there were a few government toilets or toilet halls scattered across the camp. These were communal wooden shacks with a handful of holes in the ground. People didn't like using them because they were smelly, infested with flies, and poorly maintained. And a lot of people couldn't use them because they were pay-per-use, so they preferred to do their business in the nearby bush or gulf, as they called the forest area on the outskirts of the camp. In the bush, people would encounter all sorts of wildlife. Snakes, wildcats, monkeys, and sometimes they'd encounter hostile strangers from nearby villages or the town of Kasua. Generally, though, during the day, people felt relatively safe in Buduburum. Not so much at night. There was hardly any light on the camp. Unless there was a full moon or someone had a flashlight, it'd be pitch black. Not to mention, the camp was extremely congested. It was never meant to hold as many people as it did, and there was hostility from some of the locals. There was a police station near the entrance with a gate that needed to be lifted for vehicles to enter, but anyone could just walk in on either side of the gate or through the bush. Armed robberies and assaults were common. Residents and visitors interviewed noted that it wasn't unusual to see dead bodies lying around the camp at any given time. All that said, the biggest challenge Dibe and Victoria faced in Buduburum wasn't the crime. It was finding food for their son. Hunger kills people on the camp too, Dibe said. It's not only a war zone that kills people. On the camp, if there's no food, people die, right? With us, we can drink water and sleep, but he couldn't make it. So every day, we needed to make sure we found something for him to eat and make it in life. That was the responsibility Davies' parents carried on their shoulders. They weren't worried about raising a soccer star. They were worried about keeping him alive.
We were going to survive for him, Dibe said.
We were going to find food for him. At first, the UNHCR and its partners provided water and food rations. Camp residents would line up at the food distribution center for things like kokodolos and buckwheat, which people saw as cheaper variations of porridge and rice, as well as luncheon meats and cooking oil. But most of that had stopped by 2000. The same year Davies was born, due to a lack of funding and a regional policy to encourage Liberian refugees to return home after the First War, according to UNHCR reports. Liberia was deemed to have undergone a credible election in 1997. It was an election, however, that saw Taylor transition from warlord to president after campaigning on the slogan, "He killed my ma, he killed my pa, but I will vote for him." Clearly, it was still a period of great peril. People were scared to go back. So a lot of them stayed and were left to fend for themselves.
It was especially difficult for Dibe and Victoria, who were trying to raise Alphonso with hardly any money.
And on the camp, pretty much everything came at a cost.
We had to struggle by all means to get him going, Dibe said. Dibe would sell ice blocks and perform construction work, earning just enough money to bring home some food and water.
The staple food in Buduburum, as in many parts of Africa, was rice, accompanied by various sauces made from cassava leaves, potato leaves, and palm nuts, for example. People also ate traditional West African dishes such as pepper soup, a spicy soup with some sort of meat, alongside a white dough-like side called fufu. It's not that there wasn't any food around. It's just that not everyone could afford it. For a lot of families, eating once per day was the norm. He always had something to eat, even when it wasn't enough, but at least to keep the system going, Dibe said. Accessing clean drinking water was also a challenge, so residents arranged for water to be delivered from nearby Ghanaian towns. It was then stored on the camp in reservoirs or big black poly tanks and sold by the bucket. Purified drinking water, pure water or mineral water, as the Liberians called it, was also sold in small plastic sachets that littered the camp. Those who couldn't afford these options had no choice but to fetch dirty water from ponds and wells a few hours away. In 2005, the Buduburum camp failed to meet minimum standards for both available drinking water and sanitization, according to the UNHCR's global report that year. Waterborne illnesses were common, as were other diseases such as malaria. At night, people would get eaten alive by mosquitoes. Not everyone had proper windows or mosquito nets, and not everyone could afford malaria medication, so they'd rely on plants and other natural remedies from the bush. Those worked sometimes, but not all the time. There are a lot of reasons why Davies shouldn't have made it. Although Davies was born during Liberia's darkest of days, it was also the height of soccer's popularity in the country. And this was the backdrop to his first introduction to the sport. It wasn't a formal introduction by any means, and he has no memories of it to this day, but it was an introduction nonetheless.
He kicked a ball in the back alley, in the yard, Dibe said.
Between houses, Victoria added. In Africa, we call it football,
Dibe continued,
noting that he played for his school and club teams growing up. Every kid, you gotta kick the ball. There was a particular interest in football amongst Liberians during that time because of a man named George Weah, who is regarded as one of the greatest African players of all time.
Dibe followed Weah's career closely
and even used to watch his games and practices in person when the Monrovia-born striker was starting out in Liberia's domestic leagues.
I used to watch him every day, every time, every practice, Dibe said.
We always used to go. Even if I didn't have transportation, I had to walk to go watch their club practicing.
After short stints in Liberia, Ivory Coast, and Cameroon, the turning point in Weah's career came in 1988, when Cameroonian national team coach Claude Leroy alerted Arsene Wenger to Weah's potential. Today, Wenger is known as one of the most successful coaches in the history of the English Premier League, having won 3 league titles and 7 FA Cups, during a 22-year spell as head coach of Arsenal FC.
At the time, though, he was the manager of AS Monaco, one of the biggest clubs in the French football leagues.
Wenger liked what he saw from Weah, who was in his early 20s, and brought him to Monaco for the Liberians' first footballing exploits outside of Africa.
He didn't disappoint.
Weah would go on to spend 4 years at Monaco, scoring 66 goals.
He also enjoyed highly successful stints with European giants Paris Saint-Germain and AC Milan.
Known for his athleticism, dribbling, and finishing abilities, Weah established himself as one of the most prolific goal scorers of his generation, and in 1995 became the first, and to date only, African to win the FIFA World Player of the Year and Ballon d'Or awards. If that's not impressive enough, he's also remembered for scoring one of the greatest goals in the history of the game. It was September 8, 1996, match day 1 of the Serie A campaign, AC Milan versus Hellas Verona FC. Trailing 2-1 in the 85th minute, Verona were awarded an attacking corner. But they overhit it. The ball landed at Weah's feet beyond the back post.
With a stylish first touch, he was off to the races. Weah picked up steam in the midfield. He cruised by one defender, then another, spun past a third and fourth, jumped around a fifth. With no fewer than 5 Verona players chasing him, Weah accelerated into the attacking box and fired a low right-footed strike into the bottom left corner to complete the sensational solo effort. It's a sight to see. Seriously, just YouTube it. Although he made a name for himself at the club level, Weah also represented the Liberian national team. He led Liberia to their only 2 appearances in the Africa Cup of Nations, in 1996 and 2002, and brought them to within a single point of the 2002 FIFA World Cup, the closest they've ever come to qualifying. Whenever Liberia played, people in Buduburam would gather around small TVs in the camp's video clubs to watch the games. For a fee, of course. A few times, Weya traveled to the camp to visit the Liberians, resulting in absolute pandemonium. There were huge crowds. There was looting. People couldn't contain their excitement. Everyone wanted to see King George. He was like the Pope to us, one resident explained. The height of Weya's soccer career coincided almost precisely with the civil wars in his native land, providing a little bit of joy for Liberians during an otherwise turbulent time. I had to do what I had to do, Weya told The Guardian. I decided to be strong and play to better the negative image of my country. People were very devastated at home, and I could never forget about my country. But for just 90 minutes, I could make that sacrifice and do it. In a way, Weya helped unite a country that was broken. And that was something he would strive to do again years later, this time in a more official capacity. Weya was sworn in as the 25th president of Liberia in January 2018, vowing to tackle corruption, boost the economy, promote human rights, and improve living conditions in a country that is still one of the poorest in the world. Weya's election was particularly notable because it marked Liberia's first peaceful transfer of power between democratically elected leaders in more than 70 years. Finally, it would appear, hope had been restored. For Davies and his family, however, hope came in a different form. Chapter 2. Becoming Canadian. A bright room adorned by wooden panels, floor-to-ceiling windows, and two drooping Canadian flags behind the stage awaited Davies as he took the test. The room was simple and small enough not to feel extravagant, yet elegant enough to mark the occasion. And what an occasion it was. Both Vancouver Whitecaps FC and Canada Soccer had videographers on site. The Whitecaps were set to release a documentary about his family's journey, titled Becoming Canadian, the Alphonso Davies Story. Canada Soccer was ready to announce his first call-up to the senior men's national team and get him on a plane to join their camp in Montreal. The president of Canada Soccer was even standing by, eager to present the budding 16-year-old superstar with a Canadian national team jersey crested with Davies on the back. Davies just had to pass his citizenship test. No pressure, kid. As he so often does, be it on a soccer pitch or, in this case, tucked away in a downtown Vancouver commercial building that houses Canada's local citizenship office, Davies passed with flying colors, 19 out of 20. And just like that, he became a Canadian citizen. Well, almost. Donning an unassuming white t-shirt and blue jeans, accompanied by a lanyard dangling out of his pocket, Davies entered the ceremony room where the oath of citizenship would take place. It was mostly full of fellow citizens-to-be at that point. He quietly slipped past a few of them, picked up the miniature Canadian flag that had been left on his seat, and waved it around with a goofy smile on his face. Because of course he did. The citizenship ceremony would begin moments later, with the presiding official specifically calling out Davies in his opening remarks. I don't usually pay note to any particular person in this ceremony, he said from the podium, but you should know that we're privileged to have, from Ghana, a member of the Vancouver Whitecaps, who will play on the Canadian national team, which is a wonderful thing as a newly minted Canadian citizen. So I want to pay special welcome to Alphonso Davies. Davies briefly stood up and acknowledged the applause that ensued. There was that goofy smile again. The rest of the ceremony was like any other. Together with their right arms raised, Davies and his fellow countrymates recited the Oath of Citizenship, once in English and once in French, the country's two official languages, before receiving their citizenship certificates and singing the national anthem. Now it was official. Not many people can say they're a Canadian citizen, knowing that it's one of the best countries in the world, Davies said in a Whitecaps press release distributed later that day. I'm very proud that I'm one of those people. Two lineups quickly formed following the proceedings. In one of them, some of the new Canadians posed for photos with the presiding official. In the other, some of the staffers posed for photos with Davies. There was a busy day ahead of him. He had some promotional photos and interviews to get out of the way. He had an appointment scheduled to get braces on his teeth. and he had to pack for the trip to Montreal, where he would join the senior national team for the first time. But first, as he recounted to BBC's Football Focus, a phone call to Mom was in order. "I'm so happy for you," he remembered her saying. "Yeah, Mom, I got it. I'm a citizen of Canada." His parents couldn't be there with him, but they were certainly on his mind. Earlier that day, Davies sat alone in a quiet hallway, hunched over, watching the Whitecaps' yet-to-be-released documentary on a phone as he waited for the ceremony to begin. It was the first time he learned the gruesome details of his parents' time in Liberia during the war. They'd never discussed it with him as a kid. Not like that, at least. It was the first time he heard his parents speak so candidly about the struggles of living and raising a child in a refugee camp. It was the first time he saw his mom cry. This day wasn't for the Whitecaps or Canada soccer. It was for Mom and Dad. "This was something my parents went through, but they didn't make it," he told Canada Soccer that day. "I'm glad that I could do it for them and do it for the family." Living in a refugee camp is meant to be a temporary measure. For that reason, the UNHCR promotes three durable solutions to help refugees rejoin society. There's voluntary repatriation, in which the refugee returns to their country of origin, in this case, Liberia. There's local integration, in which the refugee is granted the permanent right to remain in the country of asylum, Ghana. And there's resettlement, in which the refugee starts a new life in a third country. Although the war had ended, returning to the ravaged nation of Liberia was still not considered an optimal solution in the early to mid-2000s due to the poor living conditions and unstable political, social, and economic climate. And there was a reluctance from both parties, as well as a host of logistical challenges, for Liberian refugees to permanently settle in Ghana. For many, that left resettlement as the most desirable option. Ultimately, though, it was up to the UNHCR to rule on each resettlement claim based on the refugee's vulnerability, and, of course, to the third country to accept them. Pretty much how it worked, the UNHCR would be petitioning governments to resettle as many refugees as they can, said Krista Zongalowitz, a former UNHCR resettlement officer who worked in Buduburum at the time. "When we'd have governments coming in to look at Buduburum camp to see if they'd be interested in resettling refugees from there, we'd be escorting the government officials, taking them out on trips to see the life out there, and trying to help them understand why this is not a long-term situation." The UNHCR would post the names of those accepted for resettlement on bulletin boards across the Buduburum camp, including one just outside the yellow multi-story building in Area T that residents knew as the Mansion. People would desperately hope and pray for their names to appear. Sometimes they'd spend hours combing through the list, only to realize their names weren't there. "It was the hub for excitement and sadness as well," one resident recalled. "That could make or break you." The grim reality, according to the UNHCR, is that less than 1% of the world's refugees are resettled each year. "Refugee life is like if they put you in a container and then they lock you up," Victoria said. "No way to get out." She wasn't speaking literally, but it's how a lot of them felt. In 2006, only 1,221 refugees living in Ghana, mainly Liberians, were resettled through the UNHCR's programs, as per the UNHCR Resettlement Data Finder. Among them, 784 landed in the United States, 332 in Australia, 103 in Canada, and 2 in the Netherlands. Fortunately, Davies and his parents were among the lucky few. The U.S. was typically seen as the most attractive destination for Liberian refugees. Remember, there's a lot of history there. In Africa, Liberia was known as Small America. Many Liberians still had family members in the U.S. who were sending over money to support them.
Dibe said he had an uncle there, fighting for the family to come over.
That didn't work out, but another country stepped up.
"On the camp, they had a camp commandant, where we go into the office and they bring you a file," Dibe recalled.
"They said, 'Okay, you fill in the form for Canada.' I said, 'Why? I studied the history and whatsoever, but I didn't even know somebody in Canada here.'" Not unlike the U.S., Canada has long been considered a land of immigration and one of the world leaders in accepting refugees. Nearly 1 in 4 people who live there were born outside of its borders. And just a few years earlier, in 2002, the Canadian government implemented the Immigration and Refugee Protection Act, which placed a greater emphasis on protecting refugees over their ability to successfully establish in the country. Notably, this came in the wake of the 9/11 terrorist attacks in the U.S., which saw refugee admissions drop significantly south of the border. Canada isn't immune to the racism, xenophobia, and systemic discrimination that has plagued Black, Indigenous, and other people of color for years. But D-Bay and Victoria knew that it could offer a better life for their son, so they went ahead with the process. It was a lengthy one, usually starting with an interview at the UNHCR office in Buduburum. In this big hall, we'd set up tables, workstations, processing I don't know how many hundreds of people per day, Zongalowitz recalled, though she didn't have any specific recollection of the Davies family. And then you bring in one family at a time, you have a conversation with them, you're probably at your own laptop, writing up all the kids' names, birth dates, asking the kid, is this really your name, is this really your mom, trying to ascertain whether there's any extra information that needs to go in their file. Between interviews, health and security screening, and processing time, the resettlement process could take months, if not years, depending on the backlog of cases. One of the final steps was an orientation, where the refugees learned more about where exactly they were headed. In the case of Davies and his family, that was Windsor, Ontario.
After the orientation, they said, "You're going to this province, you're going to this province, you're going to this province," Debay recalled.
And that's how he got to Windsor. Several factors are considered to determine a refugee's destination, whether they have any friends or family living in Canada, the availability of settlement services, the languages they speak, the ethnic, cultural, and religious communities in the area, and so on. Traditionally, the province of Ontario has been the most popular destination, and Windsor, the southernmost city in Canada, was one of the original cities in Ontario designated as an official landing spot for Canada's government-assisted refugees.
D-Bay and Victoria didn't have any connection to the region, however.
Although it presented its challenges, Africa was all they knew, the only home they'd ever had. Now they were in a completely foreign land. They had no family, no friends, nothing. Davies, who was 5 years old when the family immigrated, said he found it tough to make friends because he was shy and he didn't know the language well. Victoria said she felt homesick and had trouble sleeping.
She and Debay both struggled to find work.
Initially, they relied on the government's financial support, but that was only available for the first year. From that point forward, they were on their own. But after everything they'd been through, everything they'd sacrificed, they weren't about to let this opportunity slip away. They couldn't. About a year after they landed in Windsor, their journey took them 3,000 kilometers northwest, from Canada's southernmost city to its northernmost metropolis, Edmonton, Alberta. There, D-Bay found work packing chicken at Maple Leaf Foods, a meat processing plant, and Victoria as a cleaner at the University of Alberta Health Center. Very quickly, Canada started to feel like home, and even more so when Davies' younger brother, Brian, and then his sister, Angel, were born. Their kids were safe. They were making just enough to put food on the table, and Davies started going to school. It wasn't a lot, but this was everything D-Bay and Victoria had ever wanted. If I look back where we came from, refugee camp, no food, no clothes, and here we are today, Victoria said in 2017, fighting back tears, he has everything that he needs.
Like many Canadian friendships, this one started with a game of street hockey. Cherno Fanboule, who grew up in Liberia before immigrating to Canada in 2008, used to visit his grandmother every week at her apartment just outside downtown Edmonton. Every so often, he'd see a young boy around his age playing outside. It was Davies, who lived in the same building with his parents. As time went on, they started to recognize each other. So they'd say, "Hi, hi," Fanboule recalled, and go on with their days. Until that game of street hockey. From there, he came over to my grandma's house and then it just took off, Fanboule said. Neither of their families had much, but as Fanboule said, they made a lot with what they had. He and Davies loved playing different sports, and they loved going out to eat at Subway and KFC/Taco Bell, where they'd usually get the special, two tacos, a small fries, and a drink for around $5. But there was nothing quite like Mom's cooking. Whenever Victoria asked what they wanted to eat, it was an easy answer. They didn't even have to think about it. Jollof rice. That's probably our favorite, Fonboule said of the famous West African dish. It's just rice with a lot of vegetables and chicken. Best of all, it was a little taste of home. Davies grew up in what he calls a Liberian household, from the cuisine to the language and the traditional gospel music his mom played early every Sunday morning before they went to church. He wasn't as connected to Ghanaian culture, but Ghana was still his first home. Sometimes he wore a wristband with red, gold, and green horizontal stripes and a big black star in honor of Ghana's national flag. At the same time, Davies very much felt Canadian. That was a balancing act. In those early days, Davies spoke Liberian English, or as he calls it, broken English. As Fonboule recalled, there was one time they were hanging out with a big...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.